Our next speaker, Stephen Gullberg. He comes to us from the University of Oklahoma. We're pleased to find out that they're launching an archaeoastronomy program, and they're ramping up to include more Native American classes. And Steve is also the chairman, the World Cultural Astronomy Chairman for the IAU. Getting that right? Okay. And today, Steve's going to be talking about educational strategies regarding the importance of exploring astronomy and culture. So, let's welcome Steve.
My name's Chris just said, Steve Gullberg, and I'm at the University of Oklahoma, the director for archaeoastronomy and astronomy and culture. He mentioned I'm the chair for the International Astronomical Union's working group for archaeoastronomy and astronomy and culture. So just as a quick, I'll go through this review real quick. What is archaeoastronomy? The sky is a resource that's largely unchanged since antiquity. So you're combining elements of astronomical research, archaeological research, using astronomy as a tool to gain insights into cultures, in which it keeps getting pointed out. The data that you collect has no real relevance if you don't put it in the context of the culture. So we deal with astronomical significance of sites and structures of prehistoric peoples, astronomical alignments, cultural associations. Ethnoastronomy, it deals more with the astronomical systems of indigenous peoples. So the archaeoastronomy side tend to lead more to historical, conduct field surveys using sighting compasses are accurate and good for getting some expedient measurements with theodolite, like you see in the photo there, much more accurate. GPS using U.S. Naval Observatory data. Most important, and I'll be showing some of this, is photo confirmation of predicted astronomical events, again, which in the previous presentation there was some great photo documentation there already. So I'll take you to my primary part of the world for my own research here for just a few examples. I, half a dozen times, have gone on research expeditions in the Andes for Inca astronomy. And that's me with my team at the Yaktapata Sun Temple, which is about 5 kilometers away from Machu Picchu. But some of the more interesting things that I found in my research, Laco, which is above Cusco, is a large outcropping, and it has 3 caves with some very interesting orientations. This one here, the southwest cave, has a light tube that is aimed at an altar inside, but on that particular day, as you can see from inside, I looked out and was able to photograph the crescent moon in the other direction, showing that definitely this light tube is oriented with some travel in close proximity to the ecliptic. On the northeast side, the northeast cave, this one is very interesting. I don't know how they got this cave opening to be exactly aligned for the June solstice sunrise, but it did. And in the southern hemisphere, we don't say winter solstice or summer solstice. To avoid confusion, we go with June and December. But here, in the days leading up to the solstice, the sun is rising on the horizon, moving closer and closer, and it stops right here, dead center, at the solstice, aimed at the cave entrance, and then the sun comes in, it lights up this altar. It touched the altar about 2 minutes and 8 seconds, or 2 hours and 8 minutes, rather, I'm sorry, 2 hours and 8 minutes. And further, the reflections illuminated the rest of the cave. The most interesting one, though, or the most fascinating, my students like this one, because they say this is my Indiana Jones shot, but this is a multi-chamber cave, and that's an inner chamber with a finely carved altar with a light tube above it, designed to cast light under the altar at the time of the zenith sun, which happens twice a year at any particular point in the tropics. Not too far from there's a small waka. Waka is a shrine that doesn't really have its official name, so I just call it the Waka of Solar Events. What's fascinating here is the way that the Incas carved. They were a solar worshiping society, by the way, so everything was related to the sun. They carved these 2 round circles, this big one and this little one, oriented so that it could point to where to look on the horizon for these different events. The tangential line here between the two in this direction was from June solstice sunrise, December solstice sunset. This line for the December solstice sunrise, June solstice sunset, and straight across, of course, for the equinox rise and set. And here's an example. There's those two stones and the line between them pointing to the June solstice sunrise. The Incas around Cusco had built 16 towers, according to the chronicles. We don't know for sure because after the Spaniards conquered the Incas, the priests wanted to totally eradicate any evidence of the indigenous religion, and all these towers around Cusco went entirely. Fortunately, they kept good records of what they had destroyed because they wanted to make sure that the Incas didn't bring it back again. So we can at least go by their records as to what used to be there. But away from Cusco, on the far north side of the Sacred Valley, above the town of Urubamba, there's a couple of pillars that survive on top of a ridge. And when viewed from this sacred boulder in what was the center of the courtyard of Huanacapac's palace at the time of the June solstice, you can see the sun. This is a few days before the solstice, so it's rising over the right pillar, and then at the solstice, it'll move over toward the left pillar. So they were using these pillars to mark solar horizon events for calendrical purposes, for crops, for planting, for harvesting, for religious festivals. On the Machu Picchu, some of you certainly know Kim Melville. Back in 2003, he and some of his colleagues discovered the structures on the Yaktapata Ridge. Over 100 structures have been totally engulfed by the cloud forest, to where the Peruvian archaeologists were embarrassed that this team of Brits and Americans came in and found these, because it's 5 kilometers from Machu Picchu. If they weren't covered by the jungle, you could see them across the gorge. But anyway, it started shedding more light on but much greater significance of Machu Picchu, because the Sun Temple, which I open up here with the first slide, and crossing over the river in Iwatan in the gorge below to Machu Picchu Sacred Plaza, is on the axis of the June solstice sunrise, December solstice sunset. There's a secondary potential axis for the equinoxes from the Overlook Temple across the river in Iwatan to Machu Picchu, but that's not so certain as the June solstice, December solstice one is. So there's the Sacred Plaza, and the axis coming across it, there's the June solstice sun rising behind it. The Iniwatana in Machu Picchu looks, I'm looking across here, that's the Yaktapata Ridge. So the sun temple that I've been talking about is right about here. The Peruvian government keeps the sun temple clear now of the jungle so that hikers can come and visit it. And that made it easier for me for my research. Most of the other structures are all totally grown over, and my assistant's helping with machetes hack my way in to look at some of those. But here we are back at the Sun Temple, where we were standing in the beginning. There's this ceremonial water channel that comes out from the main door, pointed right for the Sacred Plaza across the 5 kilometer gorge to Machu Picchu. The Iniwatana is just next door to it. And the June solstice sun rises here, and the Pleiades rise here. They were also a culture that observed the Pleiades rise, the Heliac rise, because when the Pleiades first reappeared from behind the sun, they looked at how brilliant or dull it was to predict their crops that year. And it was a method they found of basically predicting when they were going to have the effects of an El Nino year. There's the June solstice sun rising. Another interesting aspect of astronomy is they, like some other cultures, saw constellations in the dark patches in the Milky Way. And they had that Makai the serpent, Hanapotu the toad, Utu the bird, Yakana the yama, the baby yama, they talked the fox. The interstellar dust and gas that is creating these dark spots, and it's brilliant in the southern hemisphere, especially when you get into a dark sky. My research assistant, Carlos Aranabar, took my green laser pointer and gave me a tour that I'll never forget when we were camped out on the Yaktapata Ridge. But here you can see in another picture that those are the Magellanic Clouds. There's what we call the coal sack, which is YouTube, and the Southern Cross is right there. But the serpent, the snake is here, and there's the toad, the fox, the mother llama, the baby llama, the fox is over here. And besides the Inca, in the same section of the Milky Way, the Aboriginal Australians saw other creatures in the same part of the Milky Way, and the Macabay in Argentina saw creatures in the same part of the Milky Way as well. So now, just for some other photo documentation examples, we'll get to something a little closer to home that, you know, somewhere that many of you are more familiar with, Chaco Canyon. And again, some of you know my friend and colleague, Andy Monroe. He and I are working together to set up the educational program at the University of Oklahoma. And he's using a sighting compass there. But as I said, the theodolites are much more accurate. The sighting compasses are good. The theodolites are better. We talked in the last session a little bit about the horizon calendars, and theodolites are very good for that. Here's a calendar that was created for the horizon. You can see how the different dates for the sun's rising were marked along the way. And here, December 21st, the December solstice sunrise, you can see the shape there, and that's what's photo documented in these pictures here, the sun actually rising on the time it's supposed to there in Chaco Canyon. So anyway, now to get down to the big point today, education for astronomy and culture. First of all, why do people want this, or why do they need it? Well, one's just satisfying curiosity. It's a fascinating subject. And you see, you know, a lot of shows on the cable TV for astronomy, for architecture, or I mean, archaeology and archaeoastronomy, astronomy and culture combines elements of both. So it fascinates a lot of people. Somebody might want to just increase their knowledge in the area. Certainly develop proper research skills and publication skills. I talked about how important that can be for advancing the credibility of the field. So that fits right into becoming a credible scholar. Potential employment opportunities, might not be a whole bunch of them at the moment. I might have one of the only ones, but the part of my developing the program we're developing is to change that, at least gradually in the future. Improve and advance the field of archaeoastronomy with credible research. Gain the respect of archaeologists, anthropologists. You know, like I said, there's individuals that do, I'd like to get the Society of American Archaeology to totally embrace astronomy and culture. I'm speaking to the European Association of Archaeologists in Bern in September, so I'll get an opportunity to talk to them about astronomy and culture. Marginalize the fringe, we mentioned that a few minutes ago, and you do that through highly credible research publication, rigorous peer review. The more good quality work that's published, the more less attention anyone's going to pay to the fringe work. Where do you get an education for astronomy and culture? Well, it's hard to find, and it varies, it changes. And this is certainly not an all-inclusive list, but just some examples, some friends, colleagues, and others that I know. Javier Mujudo's got a couple of undergrad courses in Honduras. Alejandro Lopez has got a graduate course in Argentina. Julio Magli, one of the mass open courses in Italy. Rockley Simonia is part of a group getting started, a PhD program in the Republic of Georgia, the first one really that I know of. Nick Campion in the UK, he has a master's program in culture, astronomy, and astrology. I almost is coming from the International Astronomical Union, I almost hate to mention that. So it's back to the one that I know the most about, the one that Andy Monroe and I are creating at the University of Oklahoma. The College Professional Community Studies, Archaeoastronomy, Astronomy and Culture, have both graduate and undergraduate programs. And you can also take individual courses at science-oriented archaeoastronomy, almost entirely online. So anyone in the world can take the classes. There's one course will be in field research, which won't be online. That's being an elective, so somebody who can't travel doesn't have to take it. That we're going to have our first field research course at Chaco Canyon. And having students use the theodolites, the sight compasses, gather data appropriately. Exciting parts of Oklahoma's got just an amazing virtual reality department, and the kind of things they're putting together to put into our classes are just, they amaze me. And of course, we have video conferencing as well. So here are the first graduate courses we're offering. Archaeoastronomy methods, archaeoastronomy of Chaco Canyon, Cahokia, Latin American archaeoastronomy, archaeoastronomy beyond the Americas, cultural and ethnoastronomy, and field research in archaeoastronomy, which is the course at Chaco that I just mentioned. If everything goes on schedule, that the first one of those will occur next June, about the time of the solstice. The undergraduate courses, the graduate courses, the first two are launching in August. The undergraduate courses, the first two are set to start in January. History of archaeoastronomy, astronomy and culture, insights and applications, positives and false positives, identifying pseudoscience. And we'll have a separate course on that here in the graduate courses that'll be interwoven within them. Contemporary cultural astronomy, which includes even some of the cultural events with people and their annual ceremonies at Stonehenge and things, as well as other events going on. And also calendars, culture, future development, the next phase, and this isn't started yet, is courses in Native American astronomy. I'm working closely with the Native American Studies Department at Oklahoma and getting great support from the chair there. And right now we're just I'm looking for Native scholars with interests and experience with astronomy who'd be interested in contributing to the curriculum, maybe in even course development, and if things worked out properly, also even being adjunct instructors, because it's online. So if anybody knows of anyone or anyone here has interests, please contact me today or tomorrow. So once again, our programs, archaeoastronomy, astronomy, and culture. The website for the course hasn't gone live yet, so anybody who is interested, either contact me or today or tomorrow, or you can get me through my email there, and as soon as it goes live, I'll make sure you have it. Other than that, you guys here are just kicking off. I love talking about archaeoastronomy, and I got into a great field here. This is my first talk of the year here. Next week after next, I'm in Havana, Cuba, talking to some astrophysicists there. Hamilton, New Zealand, for the Native American Indigenous Studies Association. In June, La Serena, Chile, I was asked to come and talk about Inca astronomy during the solar eclipse this summer. Cusco, Peru, I'm asked to be on the organizing committee for a new conference in astrophysics and archaeoastronomy, combined in the same conference. We're in Switzerland, I mentioned, for the European Association of Archaeologists. After that, in Lisbon, Portugal, for the Proto-Language 6 conference, where they want me to talk more about the Milky Way dark constellations. And then finally, at the end of the season, at Kenton, Oklahoma, for the Okitek Star Party, which will just be kind of fun going and talking to those people. They want me to talk twice. I'm writing a book on astronomy of the Inca Empire, use and significance of the night sky. It should be out next year. And at Oklahoma, we're also working on an open access archaeoastronomy textbook. Should be done by the end of the year. And by open access, it means not only for our students, but for anyone in the world, we'll be able to just get it off the internet and use it for free.